all his life. Yeah, so it's up to you.
Where is he from?
Okay, good question. Anyone knows anything at all about Walter Benjamin? Who is he? When he was writing? In what language?
Ben? I think he was like escaping like World War II,
maybe
depression, and ended up like suicide, right?
Yes.
Because he was trying to seek refuge, like with his brother as well.
Yeah. What year?
And
Second World War, yeah?
Yes, 1914. Yeah.
Good. When Benjamin was born, then, roughly? Do you think? Sorry? You know. Oh, very good. Yes, exactly. So. Sorry? Very good. Yes. Frankfurt School is another term we might want to explore in a minute. Okay, so this is really just kind of basic framework. We are talking here about someone who lived and worked in the first half of the 20th century. Do you know anyone else we have read in this room who belongs to this roughly time period?
Heidegger.
Very good. Excellent, yes. Actually, Heidegger and Benjamin are really, I think they were born almost at the same time. Heidegger lived 30 or 40 years longer than Benjamin, because as Ben was rightly saying, Benjamin died in the Second World War. In this book, which, you know, is one of the most popular books in the library, the Illuminations collection of his essays, edited and introduced by Hannah Arendt. She also tells the story of his death, which is very famous, very tragic, not only because he killed himself while escaping the Nazis, it also really seems that he didn't have to, because he was in a party of people who were crossing the Pyrenees from France to Spain in order to get on a boat and sail to the United States. And then they were crossing the mountains, and then they were at a little border town, and the border was closed that day. So Benjamin borrowed a gun from a friend and shot himself. The next day the border opened and people crossed. But this is just, you know, this is just a story. There is an absolutely amazing and heartbreaking collection of letters that Benjamin and Adorno, another Frankfurt School person, exchanged. And there is this note Benjamin written on his last evening. That is, I cannot ever read it without crying, because it's so short and poignant. But I leave it for you to somehow explore the biography. Let me just now find the text. And I will put it in Dropbox, so we all can read it. The task of the
master, not the task.
Was he the one who was talking about the aura?
Exactly. In what essay?
I don't know.
Yeah. Well, people who read The one essay that everyone read, or anyway, everyone knows from Walter Benjamin, is the one I still actually don't read on this course, is The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. that you probably encounter, and if you didn't, it is still in this collection, and you should read this collection. You can buy on Amazon for very little money, and I think it's a good one to have. Because, let me just tell you, Benjamin is amazing. He really is quite unbelievable in terms of the way writing in the beginning of the 20th century, he managed to produce texts that are deeply, somehow, enlightening for our current condition. He's a very complex figure, very interesting, and I don't think we have we can paint the whole kind of Benjaminian picture today. But we will get into some of that in talking about this essay. But just let me find the chapter. So this is the essay. Okay, well, that seems to be sufficient. Okay, so I'm going to put it in our shared folder. Okay, so it is now in the Dropbox folder under Benjamin. So if you can just open it on your Okay, now, reading Benjamin is a kind of, it's a little bit like reading Heidegger, in terms of you need to accept the way they build their world. Yeah, they're not trying to speak to you in your language, they speak in their language, they expect you to get into their world, rather than other way around. Yeah? So I'm just saying, as a kind of, I want to flag up that the writing itself can seem like opaque, but I don't know, let's just start. Let's just read the first paragraph and see how nice it is to be back in our room. Did you find the essay? Yes? No?
I don't have access to the
Dropbox, why not?
I don't know how to use it.
You don't know? But did anyone here is working? No?
Yeah.
Anyone?
You can Google it.
Well, but I put it in Dropbox. You don't have access to our shared Dropbox folder?
Mm-hmm.
You do?
Yeah, I have a link.
But you have a laptop or computer or something?
I have a phone, but I'll use that.
Okay, but fine. Thank you.
Vinicius. Can you stop the recording, please? We just need to.
Yes.
So is everyone here with the text? Yes? Irene, do you have the text?
I'm gonna
read it
on
the phone.
Yes.
Do you want my laptop?
Mm-hmm. But are you not gonna use
it? I have a book.
Oh, I can use a book.
I prefer to have the book because I have my notes there.
Thank you.
Okay, so we try to have a start, okay? Are we on the recording of the
meeting?
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. Right, let's just see how the beginning sounds like. Would someone read to us the first paragraph? Can I ask Visha to read the first paragraph? Let's start from the title, the task of the translator. In the appreciation. Yeah,
okay.
You got that?
Okay. Walt Benjamin, the task of the translator. In the appreciation of the work of art or an art form, consideration of the receiver never proves fruitful. Not only is any reference to a certain public or its representatives misleading, but even the concept of an ideal receiver is detrimental in the theoretical consideration of art, since all it posits is the existence and nature of man as such. Art, in the same way, posits man's physical and spiritual existence. But in none of which works is it concerned with his response. No poem is intended for the reader, no picture for the beholder, no symphony for the listener.
Great. Now, you see that Benjamin doesn't waste time. Mm-hmm. No, there's no sort of, well, in this essay we're going to discuss, he goes directly for what matters. So what do you think matters in this paragraph? What this paragraph speaks about?
Appreciation.
And what does it say?
That an art form isn't made for the viewer.
Exactly, yeah. Now, in how do you understand that in relation to the show you're going to have next week?
Just do it.
Good, good, good. Just do it. Excellent. Do you agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Just do it and not what?
And don't do it for the viewer.
Don't do it for the viewer. Don't try to please anyone. Don't try to think about how the work will be received. Now, I like the last sentence. No poem is intended for the reader, no picture for the beholder, no symphony for the listener. Now, but is that really the case? Is it really true? So, it is true?
Yes, because when you are working, when you have that desire, inspiration, you are not thinking about other people, you are thinking for yourself. I mean, it's something that comes inside of you and you have the desire to make it.
And yet so often when we talk about work, I don't mean necessarily anyone in particular, but very often you hear people saying, yeah, but I want people to feel this and that, you know, or but I want people to know how I felt, and I want to tell about my feelings. Now Benjamin seems to be saying that this is a false move. You don't need to think about work. Not only you don't think about work, but thinking about your art from the perspective of the beholder or the viewer of the audience will stop it from being a work of art. A work of art is not concerned with the audience. Yeah? This is the first statement. This text is coming forward, yeah? No work of art is concerned with its audience.
I think he also says something more when he says that, but even the concept of an ideal receiver is detrimental in theoretical blah blah blah. It's like, it's,
where is it? What line?
Not only, yeah, second
in the
line.
Third, no,
the third line.
Mm-hmm. Not only, yeah. Can you read it to us?
Not only is any reference to a particular public or its representatives misleading, but even the concept of an ideal receiver is detrimental in theoretical consideration of art, since all it posits is the existence and nature of men as such.
Yes.
So Romain is also saying it's not worth it because it's not going to work in a way because you're assuming you have a specific public, you're assuming your receiver is going to be.
Exactly. He kind of says, if you make your work for an audience, who are these audience? Who are they? So you already make some, basically it means you the only thing you can assume that it is a human being. Yeah? But I guess one way to understand it is to say that whenever we think about an audience, we basically imagine some characteristics, which might or might not be true. Okay, so you could understand it as a sort of quite traditional statement along the lines of art for art's sake. Yeah, so you make art just, you know, for the sake of the art, not for the sake of any audience. But as you will see in a minute, Benjamin's argument here is much more subtle than that, because from now on he speaks more specifically. Do you have a text? You do. He speaks more specifically about a particular art form, not all art in general. And let's read the next paragraph. Could someone else read to us in a translation this paragraph? Could you do it, Ben?
Sure, yeah.
Thank you.
Is a translation meant for readers who do not understand the original? This would seem to explain adequately that divergence of their standing in the realm of art. Moreover, it seems to be the only convincible reason for saying the same thing repeatedly. For what does a literary work say? What does it communicate? It tells very little to those who understand it. Its essentially quality is not statement. Its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information, hence something inessential. This is the hallmark of bad translations. But do we generally...
Hold on. I think you skipped a couple of sentences here, at least in my book. Don't you have... Its essential quality is not statement or the impairing of information, yet any translation which intends to perform... You don't have that?
No, maybe it's a translation problem.
There's definitely a translation problem here.
Do you want to fill in the blank?
No, I think we'll have to stick to what everyone has. So just keep reading. I mean, just can you start, please? From its essential quality.
Its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information, hence something inessential. This is the hallmark of bad translations. But do we not generally regard it as the essential substance of a literary work what it contains in addition to information, as even a poor translator would admit? The unfathomable, the mysteries, the poetic, something that a translator can reproduce only if he is also a poet.
And stop here for a second. So that got a little bit complex here. What do you think is being said in what Ben has read here?
I mean, I feel like I often have thought about this, but I haven't really actually talked to many people about it, but a lot of the philosophy that we read in these courses and even on the other courses like in the school, like are all translations. So I wonder like how much is lost in translation.
Excellent. I mean, and that's a very important point. And keep this question, because I think we might be able to revisit it by the end of the session and have something to say about it. What do you think this paragraph, or this half paragraph that Ben read, what does it say? Let's read it again. Can I ask someone else to read the same thing again, up to, from the beginning, is a translation, up to, if he's also a poet. Could someone else read to us? The same thing. Lucrezia,
yeah.
Can I ask you to read?
Sure.
Thank you.
Is a translation meant for readers who do not understand the original? This would seem to explain adequately the divergence of understanding in the realm of art. Moreover, it seems to be the only conceivable reason for saying the same thing repeatedly. What does a literary work say? What does it communicate? It tells very little to those who understand it. Its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information, hence, something inessential. This is the hallmark of bad translations. But do we not generally regard as the essential substance of a literary work what it contains in addition to information, as even a poor translator will admit, the unfathomable, the mysterious, the poetic, something that a translator can reproduce only if he's also a poet?
Okay, so Lucrezia, yeah? What do you understand this paragraph to be about? Or let's put it this differently. If you look at the text, is there one sentence there that seems to you to be key or essential or interesting? Okay, can I suggest a sentence? Yes, Ben?
For me, the sentence that stood out was the unfathomable.
Yeah,
the part about how could poetry be translated?
Good.
Unless the translator is a poet.
Okay, that's very good. Okay, anything else? Anyone else has an interesting sentence there?
It tells very little to those who understand it. It's a paradoxical to me.
Okay, Julie?
For what does a literary work say?
Great. Okay, you all close. Here is, I mean, it's not that, you know, there is no right answer here. But here is an interesting sentence. Its essential quality, its here refers to the text of literature or to the work of art, yeah? Its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information. Do you see this sentence? Let's read it again. It's here, we need to just explain that we're talking in this paragraph about a work of literature, yeah? So, or a literary work. So the essential quality of a literary work is not a statement or imparting of information. What do you understand by this sentence?
I understand it in that way. It's not what you see as a word, but what you get from the word.
Very good. Can you refigure this sentence to speak about your work? Can you use this sentence to articulate something about your practice? Starting from, my practice is not about what? It is about what? Can someone do that? No? You don't know what to do. Okay. How do you understand it? The essential quality of a work of literature is not about information. It means... What does it mean? What does it mean? Yes. Or let's put it this way. If it's not about information, then what it is about?
The experience.
Excellent. Excellent. Now, can you say that the same thing about your own practice?
I could say hypothetically the
hypothetically will do for now.
My practice does not cater to telling the viewer or the user or the audience what it is, rather than making it experiential.
Excellent. You know when this will come handy? When someone will come to you and say, aren't you supposed to be doing photographs?
You mean a VA?
And you can say, what can you say? You can say, well, my practice is not about representation. It's not about making pictures of things. It is about an experience. It is about feeling. It is about emotion or whatever. Yeah? That's basically what Benjamin is saying. He says a work of literature, yeah, not any text whatever, but a work of literature is not about information. It means you don't read Dickens for the to find out what life in England looked like in the 19th century. Yeah, even though that is also there. But what Benjamin is saying is that literature is not about information. Now this might, I don't know how you feel about this statement, but some texts are clearly about information. Yeah, manuals, health and safety instructions, IKEA diagrams. Yeah, they are about information. And Benjamin is saying literature is not like that. Literature is about something else. Hello. Hi. So what else there is in a work of literature besides information? Can someone answer this question? Yes.
I was gonna say language, like I don't know, maybe I was just reading like this about translation. I guess there is like language. Like for instance, if you take away like the statement, if you take away like what they're trying to impart, all there really is like the language, I suppose.
There is language, exactly, yeah. There is language. And what is language? Language is a kind of
communication.
But there is something else, not
it's
only
philosophy.
Yeah, it sort of like tells a lot about where somebody's from, whether like you know their family treated them.
Well, that would be the information, but there is the experience part of language. Where if I say I was sitting on a car and riding in the wind, immediately start thinking I was sitting on a car.
But if you said it like in like French, then I would assume you were from France. If you said it,
but part of the conversation.
How many languages we speak around this table, just out of interest? How many languages collectively we bring here?
Like a five?
Five? I think much more than five.
Yeah.
I would think probably at least a dozen. Anyone here could read us few lines from memory, from a poem, not in English?
And then we have to translate it.
No. What then happens, I'm not going to tell you now. anyone? Few lines? Anyone here can read us something? 1 second. Can read us something, for instance, from Dante?
Yeah. Okay.
I thought Lucrezia would come to the rescue.
Do you want to read the Divina Commedia?
Please, yes. That will do, no?
Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita mi ritrovai per una selva oscura che la dritta via era smarrita. Ai quanto a dir qual era cosa dura, questa selva selvaggia, aspra e forte, che nel pensiero rinnova la paura.
Great. So what is there in language?
Rhythm.
Rhythm. There is music. Yeah. Okay. So, of course, there is some data in this text, and if we know Italian, we can perhaps get the information. But what Benjamin is saying, it's not the information is not important. What really important in language, in a sense, is what we just heard now. And I'm talking to those of us who don't understand Italian. Yeah? But we got something. Yeah? Rhythm, as Alexander was saying. Okay, so let's go back to the text, because what is Benjamin telling us? Is translation meant for readers who do not understand the original? It is his question. And of course the answer is yes, but not exactly, or not only. It seems to be No, let's in a few lines down. What does a literary work say? What does it communicate? It tells very little to those who understand it, because what does it really tell, what Lucrezia just read? Well, it says something like, you know, could you give us a very quick translation of these two first stanzas? Just, you know, in terms of what it actually says. What are the facts?
In the middle of the way of our life, I found myself in a forest,
yes.
Dark forest, which I didn't find my way.
Yeah. In the middle of my life, I found myself in a dark forest and I lost my way. Bravo. You know, that's the facts. Now, can you read it to us in Italian one more time, please?
Yeah. In mezzo del cammin di nostra vita, mi ritrovai per una selva oscura, che la dritta via era smarrita.
So you see, what Benjamin is saying is that the facts that are so scant, that are so threadbare, they don't really matter. It's not the facts that make the Divine Comedy a great work of art. Yeah? It's not the statements. It's not the information. The information is trivial. Yeah? What if you just look at what the words mean, then it is quite trivial. It stops being trivial when this information is combined with a specific rhythm of language, with specific sweetness of intonation, with the internal rhymes, and then it becomes something incredibly moving. But only when you realize that it's actually not about sort of the fact, give me the facts. Well, it's not about the facts. Yeah? It is about something else. And yes.
It remind me of Chinese pre-Han poetry. Yeah, it's basically a very important type of Chinese literature.
Mm-hmm.
And we learned it from kindergarten.
Yeah.
It's basically like four sentences. Each sentence have like five Chinese characters or seven. And one of the very famous ones is 两个黄鹂鸣翠柳，一行白鹭上青天, which means, if you translate to English, that means there are kind of what? There are two birds singing on the tree, and there is another kind of bird, they lying a line and flying towards the sky. But, well, it's quite boring in English,
mm-hmm.
but it's so beautiful in Chinese.
Can you read it to us? Do you remember it by heart?
Yeah,
can you read it to us again?
Yeah. It's 两个黄鹂鸣翠柳，一行白鹭上青天.
So it, you see how it works,
yeah.
In the same way that, yeah. So, and I think it is probably true about poetry in other languages as well, isn't it? So that that it is not about what is being said, but how it is said. Yeah? So again, transcribe that to your practice. Yeah? Now, it could be that your work has certain information. Maybe it is about actions. Maybe it is about the body. Maybe it is about cockroaches. But this is the information part. That's not what makes that into a work of art. There is something else there. So what we're trying to figure out through Benjamin's text is what is this other thing? So you see, the next sentence is, its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information. And what it says in your translation after that? Its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information, hence something inessential. This is the hallmark of bad translations. So what is a hallmark?
A distinctive quality.
Very good. Yeah. So what is the distinctive quality of bad translations? Anyone?
Just embodying information.
They just concerned with information. Yeah. So, what the bad translator will do, will just translate word for word, you know?
Google Translate.
Google Translate. Yeah. Yeah. And what this translation will miss? Well, it will miss actually the essence. Because the essence is not the information, the essence is, well, let's call it the music, or the feeling, or the rhythm, yeah? Okay, so how do we actually deal with that? So first, I think already something quite interesting appears. First, that the essence of a work of art is not representation. Do you see why I'm using this word here, yeah? Because its essential quality is not statement or the imparting of information. What representation does? Representation informs us about the world outside. Yeah? That's what representation does. That's how we know what the pyramids in Egypt look like. We know from a photograph, because that is the information it carries. Yeah? Okay. But that, Benjamin is saying, is something inessential. And now, let's go to the next paragraph, which starts from translation is a mode. And could someone else read? Yes. Just start and we'll stop you.
Translation is a mode. To comprehend it as mode, one must go back to the original. For that contains the law governing the translation. Its translatability. The question of whether a work is translatable has a dual meaning. Either will an adequate translator ever be found among the totality of its readers, or more pertinently, does its nature lead itself to translation, and therefore, in view of the significance of the mode,
okay, I think maybe that's enough. What do you think? Did you also manage to listen to it while you read?
No.
Okay. What is translation is a mode, okay? So he says here there are two possibilities to think about this mode. One is whether a work is translatable has a dual meaning. Either will there ever be found a person capable of adequately translating the text? That's the question. That's question number one. Is there someone who can translate? The other question, which is more important, is whether the nature of the work itself leads itself to translation, whether translation is at all possible. Yeah? Now, judging by what we read previously, you might expect Benjamin to suggest that actually translation is not possible. Yeah? Because if the most important part is the music and not the information, then what does it mean to translate the music of Dante's Divine Comedy? English doesn't sound like Italian, so how do you translate the music? How do you translate the rhythm? So perhaps what Benjamin wants to say to us is that translation is not possible. Now there is a very famous statement about translations, which when I started to translate, that was kind of the first thing everyone tells you, that's what you're supposed to do. And that is that translation can be either faithful or beautiful, but never both. Yeah? So you can have an accurate translation, which will not be beautiful, or you can have a beautiful translation, which will not be accurate. Yeah? That, yes, but.
I was just going to say, I saw like, between this and a previous seminar we had, when we were talking about simulacra.
Yeah.
and like Bildos and Guattari's sort of notion that if you have a copy of a photo, that it's sort of like a new version of that photo and it's never replicated.
Correct.
It sort of goes the same with this translation thing. Like, you take a text and you translate it, it's never a copy of the old text, it's always just its own new text.
Excellent.
And
that also, in a way, sheds some light on your earlier question about what happens when we read philosophy in translation. Do we really read Heidegger? Or we read another creature, which is the English Heidegger? Yeah. And is it a problem? Is it okay? So, I mean, it's a very interesting question without a clear answer. But good to bear in mind, for me, by the way, it's absolutely fine to read Heidegger in translation, knowing that this is not the original Heidegger. Translation is already interpretation, is already someone else's response to Heidegger. The question is, to me, what can we do with this text? How can we make it work? How can we ask some questions with it? It might not satisfy someone who wants to be an expert in Heidegger. If you came to me and said that you want to, you know, dedicate your life to studying Heidegger, to become a Heidegger scholar, I would say, well, then you really need to read Heidegger in the original. But if you want to assemble a toolkit with which to make your own work, then a translation is absolutely fine. Yeah? You have to be always aware that, you know, our Heidegger is the English Heidegger, not the German one. But then, you know, there is also, let's say, a Russian Heidegger, which is again slightly different. And by the way, my knowledge of the German is not great, but I spoke to a few people who read Heidegger in German and in English, and they tend to say that actually the English Heidegger is kind of better. you are nodding in agreement, Julie.
Yeah, because it's, I don't know if this is right what I'm saying, but it's already translated, so it makes it a bit easier to me.
And also because I think what people sometimes say is that he feels less German like this.
I remember we were watching the video of Foucault and who's the other guy?
Chomsky.
And they were debating in French and English, isn't it? And then it does feel very different when it's like he wouldn't really want to speak in English because
it's not his English, he can't speak English, it's just it can't express his feeling fully. And it's the same with when I speak with people who speak their own language and then speak English. Sometimes I find when they speak English, it's not like them, so I ask them to speak their language, mm-hmm. and then I can hear the voice different.
Yeah.
It's mm-hmm. like they are mm-hmm. more confident yeah. and they know what exactly the words what they mean.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's really interesting.
Interesting. Yes.
That's totally true.
Sorry?
That is totally true. Because
yeah.
never you can say something that you really want to say, because it's not the same as if you were talking in your own language.
Mm-hmm.
There is not a similar word sometimes, and also the meaning can change. And you feel it in different ways.
How many people around this table spend most of their time not speaking their own language? And what about the rest of you?
My question was about maybe a call between two languages, which is neither of them are yours.
Yeah.
For instance, that is very interesting, because it's not just about change. You have to change everything. You change your emotions and you start loving this new language.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't understand that some things you can say just in English and not in Spanish, because the meaning is different. And it's, you can feel more in this way or not.
Mm-hmm.
It is that. And also change your brain, because
so I just want to suggest, I mean, why this text is interesting, because most of us are translators.
Yeah.
Mm.
That's what we do. We translate all the time. I think, well, just from my own experience in the first years in the UK, I remember very actively having to translate what goes on in my head to another language, you know, and then at some point your dreams also kind of start to happen in another language. And the act of translation somehow resides, but never really leaves. You always engage in this process. Yeah. Now, what Benjamin is saying, and that's why this text is interesting, he's saying this is precisely the process of making art. Making art is always a translation. Not only making art, in a sense, any kind of making. An example that not Benjamin is using, but it's used later by Brian Masumi, for instance. Masumi is saying, what does it mean, for instance, for a carpenter to take a piece of wood and make, let's say, a table out of it? Yeah? Well, in order to make a table from a piece of wood, you somehow need to read the wood. Yeah? So, for instance, you need to know which way the sieves are going. Yeah? Because if you go, let's say, against the grain of the wood, you will just split it and break it. So you need to kind of read the information the wood is giving you about its qualities. Is it a hard wood or is it soft wood? Is it fibrous, you know, or whatever? And your ability to read the wood will determine how well you can make this instrument. Have you ever watched, so for instance, a luth maker, a luther, a person who makes violins?
Luther.
Yeah. Now, it's an amazing thing. You take a piece of wood, you know, a normal piece of wood, yeah, and you take some cut guts. You know, cat guts, and you take some horse hair, you put the three together, and you get divine sounds from a piece of wood, from the guts of a cat, and horse hair. How is it possible? How is it possible that you get a Stradivarius out of these unpromising ingredients? You know? Well, the only reason it's possible is because someone can read a piece of wood really, really well. You know? And if you watch a person who makes violins or... So, you know, you need to choose this piece of wood. You need to choose it very carefully, so you will smell it, you will weigh it, you will touch it, you will read this lump in loads of different ways to find the precisely right one to make this instrument, because another piece of wood will produce something completely different. Might not be suitable at all, or might produce a very different sound. Yeah? So this act of translation is involved in whatever engagement with materials we have. That is kind of the more developed point. That's why the act of translation is the essential act of art making. So can I ask you to read the last two sentences in this paragraph that you started, which will be let's say here. The question as to whether. So we are in the same paragraph, but at the very end of it, the question as to whether.
The question as to whether the translation of certain linguistic creation is called for ought to be posed in this sense. For the thought is valid here. If translation is a mode, translatability must be an essential feature of certain works.
So this is why this is important. Translatability must be the essential feature of certain works. In a sense, what Benjamin is proposing here is quite radical. He's saying a work of literature is about its translatability. This is the quality of the artwork, that it can be translated. You know, we normally think about translation as something that happens after the fact. First we write a poem, first a novel gets written, then it gets translated. Benjamin suggests that it's kind of almost the other way around. It's the translatability of the work that really makes the work. Yes, Simone? No, okay. Max and then Bishop.
And if it's the author that translates his book in another language, how do you say about this book? Is it another piece or it is the same?
It's a good question. And what do you think? It's another book. Well, what about you? What about your work? I mean, we don't need really to ask about any other artist because, you know, we have plenty here. If you make a work, and then you, I will use another word instead of translate, because translation is more specific to language, but we normally work with other things. I would say install. Does it make sense? So, you made the work, and then you installed it somewhere else. Is it another work, or is it the same one? Does it answer the question? So you see why we read this text. Because all we need to really figure out is what is the translatability of your practice. Yeah? Because we're really not here running a workshop for translators.
But in that way, if we are installing our own work,
yeah,
it's not that we are giving other kind of a view of the same work at the same time, because it's not other person that is taking your work and doing it for you. It's yourself. So it's not a translation, it's just other interpretation of it. Because when it is a translation, it's because I am saying something and other person is interpreting it.
Yes.
So it's not, or should
it? But then it's like, it's, I think it's more about the context. Like, as far as like from an exhibition standpoint, like it's a completely different context. Like I can say, thanks a lot, or I can say, thanks a lot.
No, okay, I understand
very
that
good
point. I understand that point, but at the same time, to me, it's like you are doing that with your own work, so you are not translating the meaning, you are just doing,
but
making...
As soon as you put it in a different surrounding, then it has a new context.
But
like
what
if I go and if I take a plate and I put it on my kitchen table, if I go take that plate and I put it in the Oval Office, like in the White House, it's now like a completely different plate.
If you take your work out of the studio and put it in this space or in Hornsey panel, it will be different.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not a translation. It's other interpretation of your own work, because you are not translating your work. You are giving all the
translatability, it's the translatability of your emotions and feelings, perhaps towards your environment, towards something, and then the material. So you're working at the moment with clay, of course, clay.
Yeah. With clay, but no. The minute, I mean,
it becomes a simulacrum in a way. So
good.
Yeah. That's true. But for instance, what I mean is here. We are talking about translation when other people is interpreting your own work. But when you are interpreting your own work in other way, it's not a translation. There is not, because it's your own work. You are just talking about your own work in other way. You are not translating the same work.
When you say talking,
because here we are reading a translation of someone, because someone had to interfere with this work in order to put it in other words.
So when you put your work in a space, in a crib, someone interferes with that work.
Then, if I give my work to other person, for instance, to you, and you install my work, there, a translation is happening. But if it's myself, where is the translation? It's myself who is interfering with it.
But I think that comes back to what Max said. Like, if the author says the same thing in a different language, is it the same thing? Like, if it's you installing your work at Hornsey Town Hall, or just making it in the studio and leaving it there, that would be your translation of your own work into another language. And is it the same work when you move it? I think that was the main question that Max had.
Yeah, I understand your point, but I can see it as a translation. To me, it's not a translation.
Okay. That's
the story.
The work itself is a translation, so you don't take the term off.
Yeah, that's true, maybe, because I am trying to interpret my own.
Okay, let's pause this conversation and start another one. Which one do you want to ask them?
The question that he asks is, the statement he makes about the translatability of work. But I personally don't feel that's true for art. For literature, yes. For art, I think transcendence, not translatability.
That what?
Transcendence.
Yes.
I don't go beyond what language can do. Because language, this is something I work with very constantly. Like, language is shameful. Mm. After a point of time, it stops making sense. Because if I come and hold your hand, that's as a gesture, is something that's happening. But if I tell you I'm going to hold your hand, I've already told you what's going to happen. So language, or if I tell you after I hold your hand, I say, okay, listen, I held your hand, completely changes the whole gesture or that point. So if I'm standing there looking at, I don't know, like the most famous piece of work, I'm not really looking at how what the person I'm standing to translates into what I experience. I'm inferring something. Inference and transcendence, like if it doesn't speak to me, I don't understand it. It becomes absolutely irrelevant. Because I can't be bothered. If I look at it, I say, I don't get it. But there are times where it forces you to get it. And I think that's the part of where it goes beyond the aspect of just pure translation. Because if I'm looking at it, we assume that what he's trying to say has to translate into what I'm supposed to feel about it. But it becomes a sort of, a dictatorial point of view.
What if we try to say, I take your point that perhaps what you can say about translation of literature does not apply to works of art that are plastic. But perhaps we need another word for it, there is something else. But what if we say, for instance, well, what Benjamin is saying here is that clearly he says some works, if translation is a mode, translatability must be an essential feature of certain works. So some works of literature their essential quality is that they are translatable. Yeah? So translatability is not something that happens afterwards. Translation is not something that happens afterwards. It is built into the work. It is actually its essential quality. Now, we could see how that corresponds with the plastic work of art, and we could say that, for instance, the ability to be installed in different contexts, in different ways, is inherent to certain works of art, and certain works are not like that. For instance, we might say that an Ansel Adams photograph that you have here, could I borrow the book for a second?
Yes.
Now, you could say, or at least we could try to speculate, that a photograph by Ansel Adams is kind of untranslatable. You can put it in one gallery or in another, it will be the same thing in every context. Yeah? Or at least that's how it was intended. Yeah? You could also say that someone else's work, and you can think here about your practice or other people, is very much, well, as we say, site-specific. Yeah? And you might say then that Ansel Adams' work is not site-specific. You know, because it will really look the same. Ansel Adams demanded that whenever his work, his paintings are, that whenever his photographs are exhibited, the walls are painted at a very specific shade of gray, at a neutral gray. That was the ideal viewing environment for his black and white photographs. Yeah. So whatever gallery it goes to had to basically conform to a specific standard. Yeah. So that's one way of thinking about the work. We can say this is a work that really tries to distance itself from translation, tries to say the same thing in every context. You know, if the exhibition goes to Tokyo or to Madrid or to Hong Kong, it is, the aim is to make it as similar to the original idea of the creator. And there are other works that are context sensitive, they change. They respond to the environment they are in. And you might say that these works have translatability built into them.
It's very, it brings to mind very theatre performance, because every performance, and I talk about performing arts, if I see the same play every day for 10 days, it's different.
Great, yes. So we know with the play, or let's say with the score from a symphony, that it needs to be performed. And each time it is performed, it is a different thing. Very good, Simona, because I think that's something, Benjamin is saying something like that about a work of art or a work of literature. It doesn't kind of exist in any sort of objective way. It always needs to be performed or installed or translated. We can have a 10-minute break now. Okay. Yes. could you, Vinicius,
yeah.
Could you switch up? Before the end of the term, we can do it after the end of the term, but it will be better. We have two more weeks, yeah? So on the 13th you are installing, then 20 and 21st, I have a course. So if we do tutorials on the week after the semester ends, will you still be okay for that?
27th?
27th, 28th, 29th, this kind of thing. Will you be okay? Because I have this course I have to do on the 20th and 21st. It's very annoying, but it's just the last week of the course, of the term. so if it is okay with you, if yes.
Some of us will be
here. Some of you will not be here.
Yeah.
Right. Then we will have to do it on...
when do you have the
course?
My course is on the 20th and 21st. Sorry?
Yeah, in the morning.
23rd is Thursday. 22nd, 23rd.
Yeah.
That's possible.
Mm-hmm.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right, fine. how are you doing with your research papers? I shouldn't ask.
Is that a little bit confused?
Confused.
Yeah.
Right.
To look
at are you writing a draft?
No.
No?
It's more like an idea, like ideas, right, or quotations,
yes,
but it's a lot of them.
No.
Well, do you want to talk about your research paper? No?
In the tutorial, yeah.
Why you say no, it's like not wanting to go to the dentist. Is that kind of
thing? It's the same.
Because we have this work now, like, yeah, you know, the show is next week, so that's perfectly. What would be really useful if you could shed some light on next year, what we, like, how next year is going to be structured.
Is that what you want?
Yeah.
You want to shed some light on next year?
Like, what is going to happen next year?
Okay, what's going to happen next year? Well, several things are going to happen next year. Are you okay if we talk about it for a few minutes? Yeah? Okay. Sorry? What happens next year? Well, next year you are, you will be the grown-ups. So what will happen is that in the first week of the first term, on probably on Tuesday or Wednesday, I will ask you to present your work to the new cohort. Yeah? So think about it and do something interesting.
So think about the audience.
Well,
you don't have to think about
them. Don't think about the audience. Think about the work. Now, I don't know if next year we will still have installs with fine art in Archway, because the response this year was mixed. It worked very well for some, it didn't work very well for others, and I need to figure out whether this is the best use of your time and of our resources. It could be that we will of course still do installs, but perhaps we'll do them here and in a different way. Yeah, you don't want to install with fine art?
No,
or
no.
Okay.
Yeah,
this conversation is not being recorded, right?
I think we don't like it.
Is it recorded?
Yeah.
Can you switch it off? Okay, can we read, Simona, could you read to us from, it's the fourth paragraph, it starts from translatability.
Yep.
Could you just read to us a bit of that? Irene, do you still want to talk? One moment. Please.
Translatability is an essential quality of certain works, which is not to say that it is essential that they be translated. It means rather that a specific significance inherent in the original manifests itself in its translatability. It is plausible that no translation, however good it may be, can have any significance as regards the original. Yet by virtue of its translatability, the original is closely connected with the translation.
Okay, now what if we, instead of translatability, what if we, well, it requires a bit of a violence dub on English language. What, sorry? You like violence, good, yeah. What if we read instead something like installability? Does it make sense? Can you accept this kind of word? I know it's a bit monstrous. Yeah? But can you reread them? Can you reread it? Do you see what I'm trying to do here? Yeah? Try that.
Installability is an essential quality of certain works, which is not to say that it's essential that they be installed.
Great.
It means rather that a specific significance inherent in the original manifests itself in its installability.
Does it make sense? What does it suggest to you? So remember the example we had with Ansel Adams, yeah? Which I'm not sure it's a great example. So certain works of art have this notion of being translatable, in a sense built into them, while maybe others don't. You can imagine a work of art that resists being translated, that resists being reinterpreted or reinstalled, that insists on being always the same thing. While another work of art lends itself to being malleable, lends itself to being adaptable, maybe more fluid, maybe more kind of gooey, you know, sort of shape-shifting, made of elements that can be reassembled in different ways. Does this make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Okay. Let's move on then.
So, it is plausible that no install, however it may be, can have any significance as regards the original.
Still make sense? Yeah?
Yeah,
but are we still okay with doing this translatability?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yet by virtue of its installability, the original is closely connected with the install. In fact, this connection is all closer since it is no longer of importance to the original. We may call this connected a natural one, or more specifically, a vital connection.
Okay, and now let me throw in something. You know how often, maybe too often, we were saying around this table, I was saying around this table, that it is the process that makes the work, yeah? Now, people understand it in different ways. Some people think that when we talk about the process, it means that you just bring into the gallery all your sketches and drawings and all the preparations you've done and just leave them in the space, and that's how the process becomes part of the work. But that is not the intention, yeah? The intention is not to bring in all the steps you took towards the work. It's to make the work itself bear the marks of its production. So as an example, do you remember from the degree show the piece that Samantha had, yeah? She had these four very delicate screens installed in different places in the gallery with kind of quite mysterious, not very clear images, yeah? And she installed them with the strawberry pies that acted as media players feeding into them and all the cables, yeah? Now, I think that's a very interesting example of the way she didn't bring the process, let's say, you know, the various early edited versions or whatever, but she showed, in a sense, the delicacy of the images was reflected and reinforced by the delicacy and the fragility of all the wiring, and you felt that if you just breathe on it too power too strongly, it will just dissipate. And in fact, it was even sensitive to the weather, so it would on more humid days it would not play so well. Yeah, it was that sensitive, and you could really see how it also could be sort of thin foil bits are connected, and somehow it seemed to me that this notion of installability, if you like, is really, that's what the work became about. So you might say that the video is what Benjamin is calling is information, yeah? The content of the video was the information, but the information was really not what it was about. It was all about this sort of the spider web of connection that made the piece. And let's say, following Benjamin, Benjamin would say, well, if you take the information, which is the video piece, and you, let's say, put it on a computer screen or project it, it will be something entirely different. Yeah, so that's, it's a bit like with Dante, that the rhythm, the poetry, the magic of the work, if you like, is not in the information of the video. It is in all this materiality. Yeah, materiality here is the important word, is in all this materiality of the work that was manifest in the way it was installed. Does it make sense? Mm. Now I say it, I feel really bad, because I asked Samantha for a showreel of her videos, because I wanted to show a little bit of it in Madrid tomorrow. of course, it will just be on the screen like that, you know, and it really will be the information, if you like. Mm-hmm. So it will be something entirely different. Yeah, it will not be the same piece, you know. It will be a kind of translation, and probably a very literal translation. Yeah, not a great one. Is there still a point doing that? I think it's a really good question. You know, to me it seems there is still something that can be salvaged out of it, and you know, Samantha seems to think that it's worth doing. But you understand what we are talking about here. You understand that doesn't make sense, because earlier we were asking, you know, about the translation of the work. So this piece, how you can imagine it, installing it somewhere else on a different wall, in a different gallery, will really change the work. Yeah, because it's not something you can take and just transpose. Yeah, there were other pieces in the show that were of this quality. So,
but then can we make, would that content would then be a catalyst?
The content would be a catalyst.
Because it's how it is, if say archetype, we have to take that thing. The content, not the whole form, just the content of the videos, what was it,
yes,
what was playing on screens, and just the way you're saying it, is being projected, you know,
yeah,
in a different,
yeah,
way. It would still be a catalyst, but a different kind of catalyst. Now, the only reason I said catalyst is because to get to the point where that video dictates how the form should be, as opposed to thinking about form.
I'm not sure it is the video that dictates how the form should be. It's not the video that dictates it, it's the artist who... In other words, I don't know if the content is a catalyst. Maybe we need another word for it. Perhaps the content is... What is the content? The content is one aspect. Like the work has these two sides. But the two sides are just like that, you know. You have content on the white side, and you have the mechanics of it or the production of it on the other. But it's not like you can say, it's not like you can just take the wires without the content. It will just be a bunch of wires, you know. I have them behind my desk. It's not an artwork. There's nothing to look at. It's just a bunch of wires. But the same bunch of wires with the video becomes an artwork. Yeah, the video on its own is again something else. Yeah?
Yeah,
because we had wires on your own in a specific setting can also be something. It's true. I'm not saying that they cannot be, but I'm saying that, well, there are wires there behind this TV, and they're just wires. Yeah? So we're talking here about quite delicate things. Yeah, it's not like we're not trying to set any rules or recipes how to make an artwork. You know, take 5 meters of wires. You know, yes.
Just a question about plagiarism.
Plagiarism, yeah.
Plagiarism, because in academic context, it's quite normal that they say when you produce new text, you can't even plagiarize yourself, so
yeah,
you can't use a text which was written by you before. But
yes,
it's also considered as such.
Yes.
Is there such thing in fine art education, with plagiarizing your own artwork which you already did before, for the course?
It's a very good question. Very, very good. Did you hear the question? Yeah? It's a good question, and it gives a lot of difficulties to people who teach both fine art and, let's say, essay writing, because the rules are different. In writing academic work, you need to reference everything, even if it is your own writing. At least, this is the theory. Yeah. In practice, when it comes to your own previous writing, not everyone is referencing everything. And even very famous authors often repeat the whole paragraphs from what they previously written. That's just how it is. But in work of art, it seems to me that a work of art cannot exist without continuously borrowing, reprocessing, regurgitating other works and your own works. And works of art don't come with footnotes. Maybe they should. Maybe you can make a work of art that comes with footnotes, where every borrowed or received or reinterpreted element is marked with an asterisk, and at the bottom it says where it came from. It would be interesting to do, just to see how far it gets you. Yeah? But so these are very different approaches. And I found myself sometimes thinking that while in academic writing, I emphasize to the students the importance of referencing every received bit of information or quotation or whatever, so everything is acknowledged. In a sense, in making the plastic work, almost the opposite applies. And we encourage the students to absorb as much of sort of the various influences of the art world into their work. Yeah, and then the question of acknowledging becomes very problematic. Some artists will say, well, this is done after Duchamp or after Van Gogh. You know, some people just work like that. Mm-hmm. Others don't. Yeah, so, you know, not every pop artist acknowledges Warhol. Very few people actually do, yeah? As sort of the originator of certain ideas, yeah? So it's a good question, excellent question, but as you see, it's a kind of complicated thing.
But going back to what, do you think that they don't say his name because it's so unpopular to actually say? I mean, in printmaking, though, it definitely exists.
What?
Well, you can't say, I like Warhol or I'm influenced by Warhol, you're just kind of really frowned.
It's assumed,
yeah. Yeah. So it's kind of interesting that yet we see it all the time, but we don't say it.
Well, because academic writing is rigorously peer-reviewed. So there is a whole system of ensuring that academic writing adheres to certain standards of knowledge. So for instance, when you submit an article to an academic magazine, it will have to be peer-reviewed by double-blind peer-reviewed. It means that your article will be anonymized with all your personal information removed. It will be sent to two peer reviewers who write independent reports. And if they both concur that the work is of acceptable academic standard and adheres to sort of standard of writing and has an original contribution to knowledge, it will be published. And if not, it will go back to you for re-editing. With artworks, it doesn't happen like this. Yeah, when you submit something for a gallery, it doesn't get sent to some other artist to peer review it. Yeah, so it's a very different logic. Yeah, because academic writing is seen as contributing to knowledge, and art is seen of doing something else. Doing what? Well, that's what Benjamin is saying. Art is not about information. Does it answer something? Yeah? Okay. Simona, can you just read the next sentence, which starts from just?
Just as the manifestations of life are intimately connected with the phenomenon of life without being of importance to it,
You can just read it as it is in the original.
Issues from the original, not so much from its life as from its afterlife.
And carry on.
Well, translation comes later than the original. And since the important works of world literature never find their chosen translators at the time of their origin, their translation marks their stage of continuous life.
Their stage of continued life.
Yeah, continuous. It's a stage. Yeah.
That is say stuck.
The idea of life and afterlife and works of art should be regarded with an entirely unmetaphorical objectivity. The concept of life is given its due only if everything that has a history of its own and is not merely the setting of history is credited with life.
Okay, read the last sentence again, the concept of life. The concept of life.
The concept of life is given its due only if everything that has a history of its own and is not merely the setting for history is credited with life.
That is, what does it say? Do you have any thought on what this paragraph said? Read one more sentence, please. Maybe two more sentences.
In the final analysis, the range of life must be determined by history rather than by nature, least of all by such tenuous factors as sensation and soul. The philosopher's task consists of comprehending of natural life through the more encompassing life of history.
Yes.
Something that comes from itself and not from the outside.
Very good.
Yeah.
Very good. Exactly right. Yeah. Let me read you one more sentence. The history of the great works of art tells us about their antecedents. Antecedents? That's how you pronounce it? Their realization in the age of the artist, their potentially eternal afterlife in succeeding generations. Where this last manifests itself, it is called fame. I think we need to skip a little bit. The last sentence in this paragraph, if you see it, the life of the originals attains in them to its ever renewed, latest and most abundant flowering. One sentence before that. Contrary, therefore, to the claims of bad translators, such translations do not so much serve the work as owe their existence to it. The life of the originals attains in them to its ever renewed, latest, and most abundant flowering.
We don't have that sentence. Sorry.
No. Okay. What about the next paragraph? Do you have a paragraph that starts from being a special and high form of life?
No, it starts from with this attempt.
Sorry?
It starts from with this attempt.
Oh God, I despair with this translation. I think you probably just have a somehow shortened version. It sounds like it's the same translation exactly, but with some paragraphs missing.
We have the same version. You can find it as well.
You can find it online as well. And that's actually exactly from the same book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you Google the book name and the writer's name, you can find this PDF.
But I think the poll will be okay because we only have half an hour left. So, do you have a paragraph that starts with this attempt at an explication? Our study appears to rejoin.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Okay, so in this paragraph, if you go down to a few lines, you get to grasp the genuine relationship between an original and translation. Do you have that?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, so could someone read to us from this to grasp? Could someone read? You can, I think. From to grasp, and I will stop. I think just a few lines. I will stop you.
To grasp the genuine relationship between an original and a constitution requires an investigation analogous to the argumentation by which a critique of cognition would have to prove the impossibility of an original. Can I just read that?
Yeah.
To grasp the genuine relationship between an original and a constitution requires an investigation analogous to the argumentation by which a critique of cognition would have to prove the impossibility of an image theory. There it is a matter of showing that in cognition there could be no objectivity, nor even a claim to it, if it dealt with images of reality. Here it can be demonstrated that no translation would be possible if in its ultimate essence it strove for likeness to the image.
Okay, now. Read it again, just from there is a matter of showing until the original. So it's about two sentences, one more sentence.
On the 5 points.
Sorry?
In
it's just what we should read now. We're going to go over it again. But just the very end of it. There it is a matter. Do you see it? Please.
There it is a matter of showing that in cognition there could be no objective, not even a claim to it, if it dealt with images of reality. Here it can be demonstrated that no translation would be possible if in its ultimate essence it strove for likeness to the original.
Okay, now how do you understand what is said here in relation to photography, for instance, or to practice? It's difficult.
No, he's actually just talking about that, just about photography. Okay.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Thank you. Exactly the point. Okay, so what does it say?
That representation. If you're just striving for representation, if you're just striving to be a photograph, then no translation would be possible in its ultimate essence because you're describing for it to be what is like the original.
Exactly.
That's the whole point.
This is exactly right. He says here, it's a matter of showing that in cognition, you know, what does it mean to cognize something?
Recognize.
To cognize. Cognition. What is cognition?
No.
Sorry?
No.
To know, yeah. Perception, yeah? So in cognition, there could be no objectivity, yeah? What is objectivity? Give me another word for objectivity. No.
Clarity?
Clarity is good. I like clarity because it's a very photographic term, clarity, isn't it? Another word for objectivity?
Which one?
Well done. Representation. Yeah. Well, why photography is valued so highly? Because of its claim for objectivity in sciences, in medicine. You know, I had the eye scan the other day in a hospital. So, you know, you have this machine, it reads the eye, and you have all this kind of big diagram on the doctor's computer. They look at it and they say, okay, so, you know, this is happening to your eye. And why? Because this photograph they made of your retina has some objective value. Yeah, because it is accepted as accurate and as accurate and objective representation. So there is a matter of showing that in cognition, on the other hand, yeah, there could be no objectivity, not even a claim for it, if dealt with images of reality. Here it can be demonstrated that no translation would be possible if in its ultimate essence it strove for likeness to the original. So translation, or photography for that matter, that strives for likeness or clarity, yeah, has no claim or has no potential, no possibility to be an art form. Yeah? So what Benjamin is setting up here, and you don't have to agree with Benjamin, but I just want you to know what he is saying. He's saying that translation, for translation to be valid, it has to abandon all claims for objectivity or accuracy. In other words, as Simone was saying earlier, it's not about the Google Translate sort of approach where, you know, the German word or the French word has its English equivalent. You find the equivalent and this is the translation. Yeah? That is objective, that is representational, but that has no value. So here is where it gets complicated, because clearly, are you trying to say that you trying? Okay, do you want to ask it again?
So photography, but from my previous research, has been connected to. People have connected to this notion of representing the truth.
Yeah.
I'm thinking in water. That's where objectivity comes in, but it can never offer a truthful image because it will be framed in a. It's very thing that you are describing of accuracy and clarity, but I can't quite.
Well, I think what we could hear Benjamin saying is, he's not saying that there is no point in representing reality, but he's saying representation of reality cannot strive for accuracy. In a sense, representation of reality has to be inaccurate in order to be accurate. It has to be false to be true. Yeah? It has to be opaque to be clear, or something like that, something along these lines. Does it make sense? Yeah? Now, the reason I thought it's very appropriate that you mentioned clarity is because clarity is often fetishized as the one thing that photography is so good at, or at least something that photographers should always strive for, the first thing you learn. Is that you need to clean your lens, you know, to remove all the possible fingerprints or smudges from the lens. And then the second thing you learn is that you should use a fast shutter speed to freeze motion, because if you have a slow shutter speed, then you will have camera shake. Yeah, that gets in the way of clarity. So you need to first stabilize yourself, put your camera on a tripod or brace yourself in a way that makes you shake less. You need to use a fast shutter speed. You need to use sufficiently fast film speed in order to arrest movement and show your subject with clarity. But in a sense, Benjamin says, guess what? The subject you will show in this way, the subject that in this way will appear clear in your photograph will not be true to life. Why? Because life is not clear. Life is not frozen. Life is not still. Life is in continuous flux, movement, flow. You remember how we spoke about all these different milieus that connect to each other and all these sort of various energies that move between us? Well, if you emphasize clarity as your main criterion for a successful image, you're always going to make an image which is not true to life. So you need to have an opaque, blurry, distorted, damaged, I don't know, whatever name, whatever words you use from your own vocabulary, you need to have an image that embraces these qualities in order for it to be true to life, you know? Because life is messy, is fluid, is unclear, you know? We are all in a certain state of continuous movement, yeah? So something of that, of this undecidability, of this internally unresolved state, has to be part of your image, if the image to have any claim of successfully representing it. Yeah? So here we have a question of what does it mean to translate something photographically? What does it mean to translate reality into a photograph? Yeah? So that kind of goes back to the question you asked earlier, before the break, we had a long discussion about. Now, the traditional approach, the non-Benjaminian, you know, the sort of the school of Ansel Adams approach, you know what was the name of the photography collective or group that Ansel Adams belonged to?
F-64.
Exactly. And what is F-64?
The smallest of all apertures.
Yeah. It is the smallest aperture on a 10 by 8 camera. What is the smallest aperture on a 35 millimeter camera?
22.
Yeah, F-16 or F-22. But if you move to a 5.4, you might have F32, it's a smaller hole. On a large format camera, you might have F64. Yeah, so it's what does it mean, the smallest aperture? Yes, Ben.
It means that everything will be in focus.
Exactly, yeah. It means that we will have the maximum amount of focus. Yeah. It also means that you will need a very long exposure, because the amount of light that goes through this tiny hole is very, very tiny. So to expose, let's say, 100 ISA sheet of film, you might need minutes. And Ansel Adams often measures his exposures in minutes. So he would be there with a stopwatch, not with a, not using the internal mechanism of the lens. Yeah. So maximum clarity. Can I have the book for a second? Because it is just such a fantastic thing that you wrote it. Ansel Adams's images are very interesting. I have all his books, camera negative print, at home, and I read them religiously. So this is what he's talking about: maximum clarity, sharpness, edge to edge. Nothing is out of focus. Nothing is blurred. Everything is at its maximum acuteness. It's a photographic term. And yeah, and I think we need to be clear here. There is, Benjamin is not saying that something is wrong with working in that way. And I'm not saying that something is wrong with working in that way. What Benjamin is trying to put forward is that this, whatever value you attach to this work, it cannot have any claim to be accurate representation of reality. Now, it's also possible that Ansel Adams is not making this claim, because he is not a forensic photographer. He's an artist. And this is the way in which he chooses to practice his art. Yeah? That's absolutely fine. What is not fine is the way of thinking that considers this style of work more true to life. Yeah? It would be an interesting question whether Ansel Adams actually believes that true to life is what matters. I think he was a much more sophisticated practitioner. He was too sophisticated to think in that way. You know, he often spoke, he was a pianist by training. He often said that making a print from a negative is like performing from a score. Every time you make a print, you interpret the score in a different way. So just like you, when you play a sonata, every time is different. So I think I'm not trying here to somehow say that this style of work has something inherently wrong with it. What is wrong is the belief that this highly accurate and precise way of working is more truthful. It's the claim for truth that Benjamin is taking issue with. And he said, well, no, life is unclear, fluid, messy, and opaque, and very often blurred. You know, just like when I see you without my glasses, or even with them, because they're so dirty. It's blurred. So this is the experience, if you really want to talk about truthful representation of something, the experience that you need to be concerned with is the blur, the messiness, the fuzziness, the movement. Yeah, that is the point of this passage. Does it make sense? No? Yes? Yeah? That's why, I mean, it is quite a dense sentence, but let me read it to you again. Actually, Vishal, could you read it to us again, this last sentence? There is a matter.
There is a matter of showing that in cognition there could be no objective, not even a claim to it, if it dealt with images of reality. Here it can be demonstrated that no translation would be possible if in its ultimate essence it strove for likeness to the original.
Great. Does it make sense now? Are we okay? Okay, now let's see what else we have. Do you have a paragraph which is about 1, 2, 3, 4? There is a paragraph that starts from the task of the translator consists in finding.
What page?
You will have a different page from mine.
Yes.
You have it. What
Seven.
Page?
Seven. Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Page.
Seven? Okay. Could someone read from this? The task of the translator consists in finding. Could someone read to us?
No, it's not the same one.
No?
It's the same.
You found it. Yes, exactly.
What page are you on?
It's a different view. Page 7, I heard people say.
No, it's not.
Paragraph
7.
No.
3
on the
3.
Thank you.
Could someone read to us? You can read? Thank you.
The text of the translator consists in finding that intended in fact intention upon the language into which he is translating, which produces in it the echo of the original. This is a feature of translation which basically differentiates it from the poet's work, because the effort of the letter is never directed at the language as much as its totality, but solely and immediately as specific linguistic contextual aspects.
Okay, what do you hear in this section? Anything here makes sense?
So it's not the whole image.
Yeah.
It's the echo. So what? When he read it, the translator heard it, the echo,
good.
And he translates
like
that back.
Right. So what you actually translate is not
your experience whilst reading.
Wow, very good. Do you like that? I think that was that was nice. Yes. Can you repeat it?
No.
Yeah, I think you have to write it down because this was very good. What you translate, I think you said, Catherine, is the experience you had while reading the book. That's good, isn't it? So it's not about, shall I make it a faithful translation or a beautiful translation? This is a false dilemma. Your task, or the task of the translator, as the title of the essay, is to translate or to repeat the feeling they had while reading. Yeah? So for instance, what does it mean if we talk about the installation? And if my experience from a work of art, well, let's look at Samantha's installation we already discussed from the degree show, the four video pieces. Yeah? So on one hand, there is certain information in these screens, which we know already, this is not what the work is really about. Now for me, which can be completely different for you, for me the experience of this work was this sense of fragility and how it is responsive to the various elements in the space. You know, so as I said, changing climate changes the work, you know, so it's just, and this sense of how kind of delicate and perishable it is. So what does it mean then to translate this work? It will mean somehow to translate, to recreate this experience of fragility. It could be that to recreate this experience of fragility in another context, I might not need these videos, I might not even need these wires. All I need is something that will remake. Maybe I just need, I don't know, to spread some broken glass on the floor and have a tightrope over it, you know, and just walking this tightrope will recreate this feeling, you know. Will it be the same piece of work? No. Will it maybe speak to capturing this sense of danger? Well, perhaps, you know, I'm not saying that this is a great suggestion, but I'm just, you know, it's just another example to put you in the way of thinking about how you could reinstall a piece of work, you know. And by the way, this is precisely what is also the task of the curator. I'm saying it to Sasha because that's Sasha's PhD thesis. But you could also ask, well, this is, we are all on some level also curators, you know. At the very least, we curate our own work, but we often find ourselves curating other people, yeah? So perhaps, what does it mean to curate an artwork? It means to really recreate a certain experience, yeah? And maybe recreating the experience requires very different materials, you know? Very deep, because if the work is so dependent on its climate, on its context, on the light, on the wall, on the all the various elements of the environment, once you are in a different environment, none of this might work. Yeah? So perhaps if you really stick with the feeling, with the experience, you might need different tools, you might need to start from a different place. So, do you see the challenge Benjamin is posing here to us in relation to our own work? You know, what the work begins as an act of translation, isn't it? Because you begin from a certain feeling, you begin from some sense of where you are now in this moment in your life, and then this feeling becomes in whatever way interpreted and installed into your piece, and then reinstalling will mean going back to this feeling. So that's because you remember, before we took a break, you were saying, is translation really applicable term when we talk about an artwork? Or do you translate your work as an artist? Yeah, that was your question. So it seems to me that there is a kind of answer here. That yes, you all, even before, even the first time you make your work, you already translate it. Yeah?
Yes, but
yes, but but not exactly.
Yeah, it's because when you are, because you are translating your, let's say, emotions into something else, so you are using a different mean to reach that.
Right.
But if I am doing that with my own work, for instance, with the book, I put them in other order, in other spaces. I'm not translating because the via is the same one. I am the via. But the other, the mean who is doing that, for instance, I am the translator.
Yeah.
The interpreter. Okay.
Yeah.
But so, my point is to be a translation itself, it needs to be, someone else needs to be involved into
unless,
it.
Unless, one second, Julia, we can't come to that. Unless we will say that as an artist, what you do is translation. That your work as an artist is to translate.
Yeah.
But no.
But when you already have a work, the
yes.
same work, and you're installing it in other ways,
yes.
is your own work. You are not translating it again, because the concept of it is the same one for you. But if another person comes to you and they set up this in other place, of course they have to translate it in order to experience it, the same feeling that I have when I do it in that way for the viewer.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you get it.
Okay.
I get it. But I understand.
I understand what you are saying.
Yeah.
Okay. Julie?
Such a, as the current connection, maybe the second step, but it's also final.
Of course, I think you're right. It's a good comment. It's really to do with the first sentence of this essay. Of course, on some level, the work is for the viewer. What I think Benjamin is saying is that we're not making the work for the viewer. Because if we do that, we basically only focus on communication, and the work is not about communication.
I absolutely agree.
Yeah.
I just think that the viewer gives something else to it. Gives
the viewer also translates. Yes. Yes. Was the question here? Anyone wanted to say something?
Yes. Yes. Like from the other perspective. Like once you become an artist, you kind of like translate the profession yourself as well.
Yeah. How?
Because like, I don't know, like, maybe it's something, you know, I could kind of this at the beginning, once I decided I want to go into curatorial course, I somehow like made this idea of what curators do it, and then like you try to somehow like put yourself like, on the scale.
Uh-huh.
How you understand profession, like what you're supposed to do.
Yes.
And then like this comment I mentioned, like you write the pictures people. So like again, the worst translation is like the artist who looks like an artist,
mm-hmm.
basically, but
he
doesn't.
Yeah.
Just kind of translation of profession or lifestyle on yourself as a practice.
So what is, because we're coming to the end of the session, what is the task of the translator, Catherine?
To put experience the translator had whilst he was reading words, to put that in another language, like.
Okay.
Yeah.
And in terms of the artwork?
Try to make with some essence.
Ben?
But the experience is
important. I think that, like, if it depends on how you define the translator, but if like I think that the goal for them is to try and have the same, they're trying to be the person who originally wrote it, to have the same experience, to like embody their feelings. Because if the translation is completely different, or if it's like a different experience than what the original person who's writing it was, then it would kind of be a completely different text. But like the goal, I think, is ultimately for them to sort of put themselves in the shoes of the original writer and sort of have that same experience, the same epiphanies, the same feelings. So that way they convey sort of somewhat the same feeling.
Yes. So just to summarize, before we stop, and it will take another 2 minutes. The point Benjamin is making, taken slightly broadly, is that a work of art will always have, whether we talk about literature or a painting or a sculpture or a photograph, it doesn't really matter at the moment, but any work of art will always have some kind of content, which is its information. Yeah? Benjamin is saying, don't for a second think that this is the essence of the work. The essence of the work is not what it is about. So if someone asks you what your work is about, you might tell them, but don't for a second think that this is really the essence of the work. The essence of the work for Benjamin is not its content, but it is its materiality. Its materiality is what Benjamin names translation. What is the translatability of a work of art? What is the what can be translated in a poem is not the meaning of the words, but it is its materiality. And the materiality of the poem is the rhythm, the melody, the experience, the emotion, the feeling. Yeah? Sorry?
No, this is the context we have in the
poem. Okay. And how it relates to what we just said?
Experience. We just really were sort of saying the same thing.
Good. So you see, what Benjamin calls translation is what we, in other contexts, in other seminars, call materiality. Yeah? So the materiality of your work is not its content. It is its experience. Okay. And I think this is a good place to stop. So next week, we will take a look at Lyotard's libidinal economy. So please read the first section, The Great Ephemeral Skin. Okay, great, thank you. It is in the library. It is also online.
Oh, okay, online.
Yeah, it is online.